Stephanie Crabtree. She's been coming to SFI for, when did you come to see SSS?
2011.
Had you been to SFI before that?
No, okay. 6 years.
So Stephanie's been coming to SFI since that's the SSS. She did two PhDs because one wasn't enough for her concurrently. One with Tim Kohler, who's on our external faculty and science board at Washington State University, and the other one at a very long program in French, which I'll allow you to say.
So Université de Franche-Comté.
Yes, and then there's a very long program that you were talking about there. She uses quantitative complex systems types of approaches of different kinds, including network theory and analysis and agent-based modeling and other things in order to understand the dynamics of human populations and environment and ecology over time. And so we're going to hear about some of the work she's been doing in Southwestern ancestral Pueblo culture.
Thank you very much, Jen.
Oh. Is you will soon be part of a team. Work cooperatively for success.
That is a good fortune. Well, thank you very much for that kind introduction, and it's nice to be giving a talk here. I've been kind of lurking at SFI for the last 6 years, and so I'm excited to share with you some of the research that I've been doing. I realize that I'm giving a talk at an institute on complex systems, so telling you what complex systems is a bit redundant. But I think it is important to frame why I am attracted to complex systems studies for studying archaeology and what I think archaeology has to bring science in general. So today we're faced with some pretty big challenges: climate change, diasporas, warfare, migration, and we, the smart people in the world, have suggested that we need to build models to be able to understand these events and to be able to predict where they're going. I think that if we look into deep time, we can find analogs for a lot of these same problems. Societies in prehistory have dealt with many of these same challenges as well, and so we can build models that are based on some of these things that we already know that happened. We can look at societies where things were successful and societies where things were not as successful. And if we can use these data from deep time, then we can maybe calibrate our understanding of the present and the future. This is what's driving my research program now and probably the rest of my career. And there's a paper that I wrote with several co-authors who most of you probably know that does talk about how to use archaeological systems and these more computational modeling tools to be able to build these models that can help us to understand things in the future. Even though I think archaeology is a very good approach for calibrating our understanding of the present and the future, there are still challenges with using archaeological data. For example, any archaeologist will tell you the data is fragmentary. We don't get everything that people make. The things that end up preserving are a lot of the time stone tools or pottery or architecture. And so it can be very challenging because we might not get everything from a pot. We'll just get a couple of pot sherds. We also, as archaeologists, even though the data is fragmentary, we have to kind of work backward from these big assemblages. If you've ever visited a site in the Northwest Coast, you'll know that there are these big shell middens. And those are years, if not decades or generations, of garbage in these middens that, as archaeologists, we then look at and we can see this complete assemblage, and we have to work through it and kind of telescope down to see individual processes. We also have to extrapolate social processes from the archaeological record, which can be hard when the things that we have are pots or stone tools or architecture. In 500 years, for example, this building might still be here, but no one will know that I was here visiting unless there's a written record of it, that I'm going to have conversations with many of you that are going to shape the way that I think about things. And in reality, as archaeologists, the things we care about are those conversations. But how can we get at those conversations when we just have a building to look at? Another example of this is if you go visit any of the ancestral Pueblo sites that are in this region, you might find these kneeling bins. So these are some fairly formalized structures for grinding corn. We could look at this slick here and probably be able to see residue from maize. What we wouldn't see from looking at these is the fact that the descendants of the people who made these, this is a 120-year-old picture of two Hopi girls, used this time for grinding corn as a very important time for spreading gossip, for talking about, you know, other people in the group, complaining about their parents, talking about that cute guy they saw down at the other pueblo. These were very important social formation processes, but how do you get that when all you see is residue of maize? And so with archaeology, the challenge can be seeing these large overarching structures. We look at the building and we can see the whole building, but what we want to do is be able to telescope down and to be able to see how all of the individual pieces interact together. That, of course, is something of complex systems, right? Where we want to see how the actions and interactions of individuals can lead to these larger structures. So with archaeology, we start with the final product, and we want to bring down until we can see the individual. So that is why I'm using complex systems and what I think archaeology can bring to complex systems science. So now let's switch to talking about the actual mystery of the Southwest, as many people call it. In the late 1800s, this pair of brothers, the Wetherills, they were cowboys, and they were rustling their cattle through the canyons of southwestern Colorado. They're riding along, and one of them looks up into the cliff sides, and he is absolutely shocked. And he taps his brother, and they stop. And they look up, and they see these castles in the sides of the hills. And they want to know who they are. Nobody had said anything about there being these castles in the middle of nowhere, and so they get off their horses, and they scramble up the cliffsides. And they get up there expecting to see some people, and there's nobody there. They walk around, and there are pots laying on the ground that are in perfect condition. There are storage cists full of corn cobs. And so this mystery of who are these people, they end up talking to a local reporter who comes out and takes some photos. And pretty soon those photos go viral for the late 1800s and end up in some other newspapers. And all of a sudden people in the US are obsessed with these people who abandoned southwestern Colorado, who abandoned these cliffs. This national obsession became an international obsession, and people started looking at where are these people? Who were these people? Where did they go? So originally, some of the explanations of where they went were that Athabascan-speaking migrants came down and chased them out. But on further inspection, people of Athabascan-speaking descent didn't even arrive in the area until a couple hundred years after this area was already completely abandoned. Archaeologists in the 1950s then started looking at tree rings and saw that there were many years when the rings on the trees were very thin, suggesting that there was a big drought. And so they suggested the Great Drought drove out all the people who built these buildings. But on further climate analysis of the region, it looks like there were many droughts that happened during the time that ancestral Pueblo people lived there that they survived through. So why all of a sudden in the end of the 1300s did everyone leave? And that also begs the question, why didn't some people stay behind? And why did everyone leave these beautiful buildings right after building them? I think that if we want to understand why they left, we need to understand how they lived. And so my work looks at studying the 700-year population of this region and looking at various questions, like how their society was formed, how it changed over time, and how ancestral Pueblo people interacted with their ecosystems. And so I'm going to give you little tastes of this. Of course, this region I've been talking about, we're sitting in it, but just to situate where my specific research is, the ancestral Pueblo people is this green blob, essentially. That gray box corresponds to the most highly densely populated region, and that's where most of my research is focused, because we have very good temporal control, we have very good preservation, and that's where I work. The people in this region migrated in with farming agriculture, mostly maize, in AD 600, and by 1280, they permanently left. During this time, about 80% of their diet was corn. So if you eat a 2,000-calorie diet, that's 2.5 cups of ground maize a day. So that is a lot of corn. They hunted deer and rabbit, and they domesticated turkey as well for protein. And then they also had dogs as pets. So that's the basic background of what these people ate and where they lived. I've been working, when I was working on my PhD, I worked in this village ecodynamics project, which many of you are probably very familiar with. It's this team of empirical researchers and modelers trying to understand the ancestral Pueblo past. This is zooming in on that box, so that gives you an idea of where that highly densely populated area is. This here is Mesa Verde National Park, if any of you have visited there. Very briefly, we divide up these time periods into essentially four blocks of time. The Basket Maker Three people were the first people there in this region. They built these underground pit structures. They farmed maize, and they were very sparsely populated. They had a lot of inhibition distance between their homes. That Basket Maker Three period lasts until about 750 AD, when Pueblo One starts up, and that's where we see the first really big growth in population. We see a formalization of these pit structures, and some of these looking to be more ritual, which we now call kivas, which is a Hopi word. And that's a ritual and kind of quotidian use subterranean structure. By the end of Pueblo One, there was a pretty big drought, and some people migrated out of the area to find other places to live, but there was still a population that was living in this region. Pueblo Two is marked by the growth of this regional center, Chaco Canyon. It's about 3 hours northwest of here. And at Chaco Canyon, the largest kiva that we know of for the region was built, Casa Rinconada, and here's a picture from my brother, who's a professional photographer of Casa Rinconada. You can see how vast it is. So this has a lot of the same trappings as the pit structures that people would have in their household areas, but on a much grander scale. During Pueblo II, we also have what we call the Pax Chaco, which is that there isn't a whole lot of violence. The violence that does happen is very extreme, and people have suggested it's other groups that are not buying into the Chacoan system being made an example of. Chacoan architecture spreads throughout. There are other ritual things about Chaco that spread throughout. But by the end of Pueblo II, there's another big drought, and Chaco starts to fall apart, and violence is rampant. By Pueblo III, Chaco has basically fallen off the map, and that's when we start seeing the growth of these apartment building type structures in Mesa Verde in the cliff sides. People still have some dwellings up on the mesa tops and in the valleys, essentially, but this is that iconic picture that you think of when you think of Mesa Verde. These didn't start being built until the early 1200s, and everyone left by 80 years later, so they were very shortly lived. So that's a very, very quick run-through on Pueblo archaeology. I can teach an entire course on it, so if you have any questions afterward, I'm happy to answer them. I use agent-based modeling and network analysis mostly in my research. For those who might not be familiar, agent-based modeling are computational approaches where we build these simulations in the computer that are very graphic and interesting to look at, where we can let individuals act and interact together. We give them rules that they follow, and we run the simulation to see what the output is. With the network analysis, I have done social network analysis. Today I'm going to be talking about this food web analysis, which is stuff that I started working on with Jennifer Dunn in 2011. She really influenced my work. Another reason why I model, and I have to include this quote because I just think it's incredible. Wind back of the tape of life to the early days of the Burgess Shale, Stephen Jay Gould said in 1989. Let it play again from an identical starting point, and the chance becomes vanishingly small that anything like human intelligence would grace the replay. So this idea takes this concept of that you can't go back in time and run experiments. We have a final product here now. So how do you go back and see what was happening then? That's why I model. Modeling can provide a way to wind back the tape so that I can create experiments on the archaeological record, create a digital archaeological output, and compare that against what we see. All right, so I'm going to move on to talking about my first case study, which is hierarchy in the ancestral Pueblo Southwest. As I mentioned before, Chaco shows up in Pueblo two times. By the mid-1000s, it's becoming this very big polity. This is a picture of Pueblo Bonito, which is one of the biggest settlements, constructions in the region. And people have hypothesized that it is it demonstrates a hierarchical organization. There are individuals who are buried there who are buried with turquoise, with chocolate, with macaw feathers, which things that are very high status goods. But you look elsewhere in the Southwest and you don't see high status things. This is one individual or a couple of individuals in this burial. People who have worked more with the ethnographic descendants of the people who built these structures have noted that these people are highly egalitarian. They have mechanisms in place to make sure that people are equal, more or less. There's some inequalities in people who hold ritual in one place or another, but you don't see aggrandizement. And so there's been this debate in archaeology, were ancestral Pueblo people hierarchical? With some people saying, if you look at Chaco, of course it's hierarchical. You see these giants, this giant site. And with other people who say, if you look to individual sites, you can see that people were more or less equal based on their material goods. So I built this simulation to examine the possibility of the development of hierarchy over the 700-year period. So building an agent-based model, assuming that hierarchy could happen in this region, and comparing some output from the model to things in real life to say, did it happen, if it did, when, and if it did, where. I employ analyses that compare these distributions of kiva size, of site size, and territory size in the simulation. The reason I do this is that idea of it's hard to look at social processes in the past. We have to look at things that preserve. So I have architecture at my fingertips. So looking at how could these sites have developed as they are if it wasn't a hierarchy that developed them. I'm not going into a lot of details on the simulation. If you want those later, we can go over them. This is all I'm going to tell you. It's built on the Village Ecodynamics Project simulation, an 1,800 square kilometer region in southwestern Colorado. That has realistic landscape. It has a retrodicted climate that runs in the background. Agents are households that run around and hunt deer, raise, grow maize, and reproduce, and move their houses if the rain doesn't come in, essentially. Agents in this updated version, we built in some territoriality. So in creating this new model, we updated a lot of the code to simplify it so that then we could build this extra model on top of it. So this new branch of the model, which we call polity, agents track their matrilineage. So at the beginning of the simulation is seeded with 200 households, and each of them is given a unique matriline. Those matrilines can then own the patch that they land on. And as they reproduce and their offspring come out, their offspring can take a different part of the landscape. So we'll have households that form a territory where we have polygons incorporating them, and then other households that form a territory for another group. Now, this territoriality in this new version of the simulation in polity is important because as groups move, as populations grow, and as groups have to move, you might have them coming closer to another territory. And then if another household needs to move over here, this part of their territories might overlap. When that happens, they may engage in a form of conflict, and there are a whole lot of algorithms that we go through to decide if they're doing that for the heuristics of it. We end up using, if they do engage in conflict, Lanchester's laws, that we build in stochasticity into them. Lanchester was a brigadier general in World War I, and he wanted to be able to predict the outcome of battles, and so he developed many coupled differential equations to be able to predict, based on the size of the army and what their technology was, what's going to happen. So what we did was use those as a background, which many other people have done in their simulations, but built in stochasticity, because we understood that even if a group has fewer fighters than another group, that maybe there would be something that would swing in the favor of those with fewer fighters. So this is all formalized here, and we can talk about that later if you'd like. But what ends up happening in this is when groups come into conflict over land, and when agents decide to fight over that, you might have one group that becomes dominant over the other. So let's just say that this one wins and this one loses. And so a chain of hierarchy is developed. What happens with that is that the winner will then protect the loser if it comes into conflict over another group, let's say over here, that wants to contest them over land. But what the loser has to do is pay a very small tax of maize to the winner So there is some kind of benefit for the winner in the group. That's the... Yes. Yes. We can talk about that later. In the simulation, we can see the exact mechanisms that happen. So there has been a lot of anthropological research into taxes. A lot of this research in taxation is in the Maya region. We don't have evidence of that in our region, but that's for a lot of different things. So we're taking some kind of liberties looking at other anthropological cases, but building them and saying, could this be possible based on these things that we know happen in other somewhat comparable systems? In this simulation, what you're seeing is the development of these hierarchies. These are center points. The size of the circle corresponds to how many households are in the group. And the arrows flickering on and off are whether or not they're revolting against them. Black versus grayish color is how much they're paying in their actual tax. Red versus blue, I'm not going to talk about that right now, but if you're familiar with Paul Hooper's work on the development of hierarchy, that corresponds to whether the individuals in the specific group at the top have decided to elect a leader or not within their group, not for the larger overarching groups. So what this is showing is how these tribute dynamics form and what ends up happening over time. So looking at whether these chains form over time or not. One of the things that I did for this is calculating the territory of the groups that end up in these large complex groups. So drawing polygons around everything that is encapsulated to look at that as the archaeological output. So that is the thing that I can measure from this simulation is how big are their territories? How many people are in there and what are they counting as their territories? When I compare that, I can look at some other data that I aggregated from the archaeological record. So I have data of kivas of varying sizes from household kivas to casa rinconada. I have the size of households throughout the entire 700-year population of this region. And so then I can look at distributions of the sizes of these to compare them against each other. That way it's a little bit agnostic. Yes. More or less, yes. So there are many things that people could use as a public good. And so in an earlier iteration of the simulation, they played a public goods game. And public goods could be things like building a tower, building a wall, building a great kiva. Those are difficult to operationalize in a simulation because what kinds of benefits do you get from those, right? They're kind of intangible. You get to meet other people and potentially have marriage partners. So in the simulation, you have to decide there needs to be something that gives a payback for these. So in our simulation, we use this maize as a public good. So you pay in a little bit, and it multiplies if everybody pays in. And so we're using that essentially in having a tax being paid through as well. I realize that it's very simplified and that there are many different things that people could have used and that people have argued that Chaco would have been a place that people came together, walked for miles away, and helped build together. But that's a very difficult thing to necessarily operationalize in the simulation. So I've simplified it down to be just a simple, we grow extra corn and we help pay for protection, because there is evidence that there was rampant violence at different times in this region. And so it's the choice I made. There are many different choices I could have made. So, but thank you very much. That is a good clarification. So one of the biggest challenges, I think, of getting from these conceptual models to the archaeological record is being able to find ways to compare them. And so what I tried to do is find something that was agnostic of where these settlements were so that I could just compare the distributions of the data to give some kind of a big picture. And what I ended up doing was looking at these distributions according to either a log normal or a power law analysis. Now, the reason that I did this is that log normal distributions follow a process where everything grows proportionally to the other, right? Where a family of four, if they're all roughly the same metabolism and the same size, should eat twice as much as a family of two, right? it should just kind of grow on the same scale, essentially. Power law is also known as the law of preferential attachment, or this idea of the rich get richer. And so something, when something increases in size, it could potentially outpace what should be expected by what you would see with a log normal distribution. So in the above example, if the family of four is actually much wealthier than the family of two, let's say the family of two is on marginal land and they cannot grow enough food, then maybe we would expect to see that the family of four wouldn't just eat twice as much, but maybe four times as much, because they're so much wealthier than the other family. Incomes also seem to scale log normally up to a certain point at which they correspond to a power law. So I'm not saying that power laws are magical and I detected them in my data set. But what I am saying is that by using this tool, I can say something about whether or not, if we see power law distributions in the distribution of kiva sizes, household sizes, and simulation polity sizes, that might tell us something about whether or not people were engaging in hierarchy. We would expect to see very few of the very large sites and many of the very small sites. This then simplifies the analyses, and it doesn't matter where the kivas are, it just matters whether they conform to the data. So I did this for all of the simulation runs and for all of the kiva results, and just, I know it's data tables that you can't read, but what we care about is whether or not these corresponded to a power law or a log normal. And I do want to point out that the simulation results are from central tendencies of multiple runs of the same parameters. So these are not one-off simulations. What my results ended up showing was this more consolidation of power. We see power laws emerging in Pueblo 2 times, and we see them breaking down in Pueblo 3 times. With Pueblo 1, when we have a lot of small sites kind of distributed around the landscape in the archaeological record, as being kind of log normal-ish. So what we see here is this potential consolidation of power in Pueblo 2 with Chaco Canyon as the apex of hierarchy. We see this in the Kiva data set. We see this in the settlement data set. And I do see this emerging in the simulation. In the simulation, we also see conflict increasing when maize productivity gets low and agents invade other agent territories. In real life, we see conflict when Pueblo 2 falls apart. And in real life, that corresponded with some years of drought. During Pueblo 3, we see this power becoming more regionalized. We don't see power laws across the area. We see log normal and power laws cropping up in other places. What this may tell us is that people are consolidating into more local structures. People are building kivas for just their small enclave and becoming more centralized in their own region instead of being belonging to this larger area. And so I think that what this can say about the archaeological record is that it is possible that polities developed, that you can look at how this develops in the simulation, and that this shows some kind of explanatory process when we look at the archaeological data. I can't go into a whole lot more details on that, but if you want to read on this, I had this research published in American Antiquity a couple of months ago, and I'm happy to share that paper with any of you today. So people may have, woo, yes, and yes.
Talk about that there were conflicts between the Pueblo people and hunter-gatherers. Is this a major force? Is it included, or you just model conflicts between Pueblo people? Right?
So there were hunter-gatherers who were living in the region before the Pueblo people came in very, very low numbers, and they generally disappear from the archaeological record during the time the Pueblo people are there, and there's not very much evidence of hunter-gatherers being there. 250 years after these regions were depopulated, we had the Athabascan-speaking people like the Navajo coming into the region, migrating down from up north. So there was no evidence of interaction between them. There are some old archaeological texts from the 1950s and 60s that talk about that being a force, but we don't actually have evidence for that. And so sometimes these narratives are still used. There definitely was contact between hunter-gatherers living on the periphery. We can see trade of bison, for example, and we can see trade of maize going east of Durango, Colorado. And so it looks like there was contact, but we don't have a lot of evidence of conflict from them. The things that look like conflict look like they came between Pueblo people. It's contentious, but people are looking into it. What were you going to ask?
I was just wondering how you, so you said that the simulation matches these different phases, but I was wondering how you synchronize the clock between this, between the real world and the simulation, if that's just a...
Right, so the simulation goes on annual years, and the estimates at the household level we can get down to about 20 years, and Kiva size estimates we get down to periods, which are around 100 years.
And the real world years and the simulation years are synchronized through weather or something, and that causes these transitions, or I'm just curious about, say, initial conditions mattering and that sort of thing.
Yes, so the simulation is built on... We have annual time steps, and within those we have four seasons, and things happen in different seasons. People plant maize in the spring, people harvest maize in the fall, and so there are four steps within each time step in the simulation. And so they do correspond roughly to what a calendar year would be like. And so I use the initial condition of 600 AD as the initial year of 600 AD in the archaeological record. Generally speaking, with the simulation, because, you know, the first 50 years, weird things happen, I don't look at that data. And so I'm not even comparing against that data. Really, when I do these analyses, I'm talking about Pueblo 2 and Pueblo 3, more or less. So letting the simulation run for a little while. In terms of trying to downscale, essentially, where I have annual data for the simulation and I don't have annual data necessarily for the archaeological record, some things we can get annually, but a lot of things we can't. It's about aggregating the data at whatever scale I'm trying to compare it against and taking the mean central tendencies of that, right? So trying to get a distribution from that amount of time. So that's essentially what I do when I'm trying to compare against different time scales. It's hard in archaeology because not everything is comparable.
Okay. Do you also have information about the intergenerational demography in terms of like fertility age and life expectancy of things that help calibrate?
Yeah, so the region where I work has very good preservation and the benefit of 125 years of archaeological investigation. And Tim Kohler did some work on the Neolithic demographic transition in the area and calculating those birth rates and the growth. We have very good demographic reconstructions of the population for the entire region. Then we can look at subregions within there. And so there is plenty of data against which to compare everything that does go into these analyses. David.
So your simulations actually went through the 700 years, give or take 50, shaking down, and you got the actual transitions occurring at corresponding times that they did in reality. Do I understand that correctly?
Más o menos. Yeah, so the annual trajectory within the simulation, we've retrodicted the climate. And so we are taking that from real life. And so that clock corresponds to what ancestral Pueblo people had to face for that time. And so that should be completely comparable. And like I said, generally speaking, the first 50 years, because we seed the landscape with 200 agents, and they're randomly seeded on the landscape. A lot of them end up dying because they're in very terrible conditions. And so that's why I don't look at those first couple years of data, because it's going to be all over the place. But then once you get past that initial die-off, you can start really looking at these. And so running the simulation multiple times and getting those central tendencies and then comparing that against what I have archaeologically, that's what I end up doing. All right. So I'm going to talk about food webs very briefly. And I might have to go through this a little quickly. But I was interested in this because we're looking at society, we're looking at hierarchy, we're looking at violence, we're looking at trade of maize and people eating 80% of their calories are maize. Well, what was the interaction of these people with their environment? And I think a lot of your questions have gotten at that, like what is the environmental background? And so we need a different approach to be able to do that. And so that's why I was drawn to the work of Jennifer Dunn, looking at food webs and looking at ecosystem connectants. So I want to know if food web approaches can help shed light on this problem of depopulation. Can we look at how farming peoples, who were still connected to the ecosystem, though they had this buffer where they're growing their own food, of course, but how were they connected and what importance does this have? You probably all already know what a food web is, but for me, I learned about it from Captain Planet. And food webs are essentially food chains all brought together. So we have our primary producers, plants, that are eaten by herbivores, that are then eaten by omnivores, and then eaten by carnivores. And when you connect all of these connections, these little chains together, the bear isn't just going to eat a caribou, it's also going to eat some of the berries, it's also going to eat some salmon. Then we get a large food web. And so by putting all these together, we can use network statistics to understand where there are important species, highly connected species, where there are less important, less connected species, and what happens when you remove some of these species. Using an archaeological record where we have very good preservation is excellent for looking at this because we know what happened. We know people lived there for 700 years. We know there were droughts. We know people left. So what were people eating? Where were the extinctions and how did this happen? So I create first a composite food web. So this is looking at everything that Pueblo people ate from multiple sites over the 700-year period. I also am modeling every species, non-invasive species, that exists in this region today, both by looking at what's in the archaeological record and what lives there today, and then compiling their feeding links based on these species that exist. Nothing that is in that the Pueblo people interacted with has gone extinct. So this is based on data from what they're doing today. I then can look at individual sites, though I'm not going to go through that data with you today unless you have questions about it afterwards. And I can look at human prey choice. I can look at what happens because of this prey choice. What did people do to the ecosystem? And eventually examine how hunting and farming decisions ended up affecting the environment. So when I look at all of these species and compile them all together, what I end up with is something that looks like this. So this is the empirical food web of the ancestral Pueblo people who are pointed at by this arrow here. All of these at the bottom, these red nodes, are plants. This is created by Network 3D, a piece of software that Jennifer Dunn helped develop. The orange, red-orange balls are the primary consumers. So those are herbivores. The kind of orange-yellow, those are omnivores. True yellow are carnivores. Nose rings, loops, indicate cannibalism. So pumas sometimes eat their young, for example. And what you can see here is even though this is a desert ecosystem, and even though humans are farmers, they are still highly connected, and this web is highly knit together. There are 336 species represented here with 12,800 more or less connections among them. So this gives us an overall picture of the complexity of the Southwest food web, but when we look at various metrics, one of the metrics I can look at is vulnerability to predation. So how many things eats you? And compare that across all of the different species. So when I look at how many things eat you, humans are fairly low. There are a few large-bodied mammals that eat them, wolves and pumas, and humans sometimes eat humans. Deer, there are more things that eat them, though they're not highly vulnerable to predation. But maize is one of the most vulnerable plants to predation. Humans brought it in. It is not native to the Southwest. It came from more tropical regions. But when people brought it in, it is likely that all of the species that eat grain up there fell in love with it. When I was compiling this data, there are species that are in Colorado, such as the sandhill crane, that are said to be pests on modern corn farmers' fields, that people have to go out there with fans and chase them away during their breeding season. So this is something that ancestral Pueblo people may have had to deal with. Not only is 80% of their diet coming from corn, but everything else on the environment wants to eat it too. So they have to protect it or grow more to make sure that they have enough for themselves. I can also look at how connected a species is to every other species on the environment. And what that tells us is not only what's preying on you, but what are you preying on? Obviously, maize is not preying on anything. Maize is very highly connected for a plant, but humans are really highly connected. They're not eaten by many things, but they eat a lot of different things. But remember that I said 80% of their diet on a regular year comes from corn. So a lot of these are very, very small, very narrow links. But what this can tell us is that potentially Pueblo people could prey switch. On years when maize didn't come in, they may be able to rely on some of those other weedy crops. on years or days when they couldn't get a deer, they may be able to rely on other game in the neighborhood. So that's what these metrics can tell us. Some of the things that ended up happening are unintended consequences. So when you're compiling large data sets like this together, which people haven't really done yet for the Pueblo region, you start to notice patterns. People have known for a while that by the end of Pueblo 1, beginning of Pueblo 2, there's not a whole lot of deer left on the landscape. But in compiling these data, I looked at many different rabbit and hare species, as well as deer, and their overlapping preferred browse. Their preferred browse overlaps, especially in the wintertime. And that is the most vulnerable time for a lot of these animals. Rabbits also can live in maize fields. They are not bothered by human disturbance, as probably most of us know, walking through an urban environment and seeing bunnies everywhere. They also have a higher fecundity rate. And so deer may have been doubly burdened by being hunted by people and by having their food overlapping with preferred food by rabbits and having rabbits being able to survive when ancestral Pueblo people were going into this environment and clearing things out. Farming also had some unintended consequences on the environment. We know that you have to clear the landscape to plant a field. When you clear that landscape, you are clearing trees so that you can burn them, so you can build your houses, and so you can make sure you have your maize fields. This is going to increase erosion, potentially, and it's also going to make it so people have to go farther afield for other weedy species. So as long as density is low, people may be able to go out and get these trees and these weedy species that they want. But when density gets higher, it becomes more difficult. Another thing that I noticed when compiling these data is that in Pueblo 1 times, there are many species that rely on woody corridors, like snowshoe hare and elk. In Pueblo 1 times, they are in the middens. However, these end up disappearing from the midden assemblages by Pueblo 2, and by Pueblo 3 times, they're gone. And instead, we have scaled quail and sandhill crane, which are two species that do not live in this region. If you look at the Audubon records for the region, since 1909, there have been 3 sightings of scaled quail and 9 sightings of sandhill crane, but these are in the middens. What this suggests, potentially, is that the clearing out of the landscape to make way for your maize farms ended up creating a habitat that is better for these species that grow, that live in northern New Mexico and that live in eastern Colorado, that were then attracted to coming up to this region because of the cleared open prairie. So I suggested that because humans are connected to a lot of different things, they could prey switch. But by the end of the population here, by 1260, there were 27,000 people living in the region. That is as many people as are living there today, and today they have Safeway and Walmart. If there are that many people living on this region, you're going to be bumping up against each other. And we also saw this in the simulation, when people ended up bumping up against each other. This clearing of the landscape, this high population, is going to affect whether or not you'll be able to prey switch. And so I suggest that they could only prey switch when populations were very dense, were less dense. The wealthier settlements may have had preferential access to some types of meat, which is something I'm starting to look at today when I'm looking at different settlements in the region. This is a very glossing over of this research, but I published it just a couple months ago in Journal of Archaeological Science, and there's a lot more about it I can say. But let me just wrap up with, I think, some overarching themes of my work. If we look at other research in the Southwest, we can see that the ecosystem was potentially fairly vulnerable later in the population of the region. Pollen cores that were taken from the feature of Mummy Lake on top of the Mesa Verde landform show that there was clear cutting of forests during Pueblo occupation. By 1200, the amount of pollen that are in these cores is comparable to modern cores where the nearest trees are about 15 to 20 miles away. So that tells you how denuded this landscape would have been. And then after the Pueblo people leave, about 50 to 100 years later, the pollen starts increasing, and you look at these pollen cores, and it becomes very abundant after people have been gone for a while. So the clearing of the forest is a very quick environmental change, but the recolonization is a very slow process, and it takes hundreds of years of people being gone for that to happen. Work by some of my colleagues has looked at precipitation in the region and where you could grow maize, and so this is just showing you what some of these dry years were. This is the abandonment time. And so there is repeated droughts in this region, followed by many cold years. Hopi today talk about making sure they have 3 years of grain on hand as storage in case these bad years happen. But we see that this happened throughout the entire time that people were living in this region. So they're denuding their landscape. They're dealing with droughts and with cold years. And so this is all leading together. I mentioned that there is increased violence in here. I don't have that data in this presentation right now for you. We can talk about it later. But I think that together, this increasing of violence, the unpredictable moisture, erosion, scared and hunted off prey, these all likely led to a lower quality of life for the ancestral Pueblo people. As populations grew, new families had to move into marginal lands, and these marginal lands may not have been able to produce well during drought. In the simulation, these marginal lands tend to be some of the places that end up being contested in the territories that lead to violence as people are coming and bumping up against each other as populations are skyrocketing. When we look at the archaeological record, we can see that farmers who colonized the marginal lands were the first to abandon this region. So the abandonment happens in total between 1280 and 1300, but the first households that are gone are on the worst productive landscapes. In the Southwest and in elsewhere in archaeology, we can look at large patterns, but I think that this work shows that individual decisions matter. It matters where you choose to move on the landscape. It matters if you choose to intensify farming for whatever reason. And it matters when you decide to hunt and what you decide to hunt. These choices aggregate together, and they end up creating these larger overarching patterns. These choices that the ancestral Pueblo made were optimal for the short-term solution, but they ended up having long effects that ended up being ultimately negative for the people in the region. However, I would say that these people were resilient because they were able to migrate away from the region and maintain a culture that we can still see and visit today. They migrated out, and these cultures have continued. But we can look at this and think of some lessons, of course. This is a picture from the International Space Station of forest fires in the state of Washington last year. After 150 years of deciding to suppress forest fires because it was optimal in the short term, we're having these large cascading consequences of gigantic forest fires. Where is that tipping point, and where can we look in the archaeological record to look at how these decisions can manifest over time to create these large problems? I'd like to thank many of my collaborators who are pictured here on many of the different projects that I've been working on who have led to the success of this work. And thanking, of course, the funding agencies. And if there are any residual questions, I'm happy to take them. Did we get all the questions out of the way already?